this video, I'm going to show you how I surprised one of my Twitch viewers by making a custom PCB for their project. I've been live streaming on Twitch for a number of years now, and in that time I've picked up a few followers and subscribers. The objective of my content is to inspire the creative flame in others by showing if I can do it, anybody can. One such viewer got inspired and took the plunge into something that was completely outside of their comfort zone. Not only are they inspired to start off in the world of 3D printing, they've also taken the plunge with Arduino and electronics. This viewer is Carol, and she goes by the name of Chubby Pug Cosplay. Carol is no stranger to making. She makes awesome costumes for members of her family, and up until recently was a handler at conventions. That was until, you know. Anyway, after watching my streams, Carol wanted to give 3D printing a try and got stuck in with a Prusa i3 Mark II. The taste of success has well and truly given her momentum and set her on a path for bigger and better things. And that brings us up to date. Carol has created a wonderful example of a Harry Potter inspired book nook. Not only has this been printed really well, the paint and weathering is amazing. If that wasn't enough, Carol has also set up a light and sound show using an Arduino that controls an MP3 player and a set of NeoPixels to create a stormy atmosphere. So as a thank you to Carol and have another opportunity to inspire, I decided to make Carol a custom PCB from scratch that she can then use in a project and possibly send away to have it professionally made. The process of making anything is easy if you break it down into manageable chunks. The more complex the project, the more chunks you'll have to work through before you have a finished project. Before we start our project, let's see how the professionals do it to see what we need to replicate this process. A circuit board starts off with a design. A manufacturing house first checks the files from the customer, making sure they don't have any obvious errors. A copper clad board is then cut into manageable sizes from a master sheet and fed into a computer controlled drilling machine. This machine then drills all the holes for the through hole components and vias. These holes are then plated to make the connection between one side of the board to another. Once plated, the design of the circuit is then transferred to the board. This is done by coating the board with a UV sensitive ink and then exposing it to light to cure or harden it. Once the ink is cured, the board is then passed through an acid bath, which dissolves the copper that doesn't have any ink protecting it, revealing the copper traces beneath. Now we have an etch board. It's inspected to ensure that the etch process is complete and there aren't any areas where the traces have been damaged. After passing this check, the board has a solder mask applied and baked. The mask job is to protect the bare copper traces and to expose the pads where solder will be applied later to attach the electronic components. The master board is placed into another CNC machine, this time to cut the individual circuit boards out of. The boards then go through another inspection before they are washed and dried and then packaged up to be sent to the customer. So we know from how the professionals do it that we need a couple of things. First of all, we need a design or a schematic, we need a circuit board layout, we need the means to transfer that circuit layout onto a circuit board, we need the ability to remove the copper to reveal the traces, then we need to apply a solder mask, and then it's final assembly. Luckily for us, Carol followed an online tutorial on how to put this circuit board together on a breadboard. We're going to use this tutorial to draw a schematic, then create a board layout, and then apply it to a copper cladded board, at which point we'll etch it away to leave the copper traces, and then it's a case of applying a solder mask and putting it together. This is the breadboard layer from random making encounters. We'll need to pay attention to the components used and how they're connected. From this image, we'll need to create the schematic or technical drawing of the circuit. Using Fusion 360, I create a new electronics project and import all of the components into the drawing. Following the breadboard layout, I then connect all of the components, taking care to make sure I've not missed anything. From here, we switch over to the board layout tool. Here I'll create the copper traces that will make up the physical circuit. I place the components in a defined space that will be the board size in a way that makes sense. Using the autorouter function, I have the computer find a path for all the copper tracks, so they fit on one side of the board without any jumper wires. Now it's time to transfer this board layout onto the copper cladded board. We do this using an etch mask. An etch mask is a representation of the copper tracks printed out on an acetate. Now there's probably a better way of doing this, but I don't know it. So this is my current process, don't judge. From Fusion 360, I print out the circuit layout as a PDF. Having the file as a PDF means that I can edit it in a vector image application, like Adobe Illustrator or something like that. I'm gonna use Inkscape as it's free and it's something I already have and I know how to use. I break out the tracks, pads, and the board shape into their own layers. Once separated, all of the elements need their colors inverted, meaning that white areas will represent the traces that will get exposed to UV light, and the dark areas will get washed away, enabling them to be etched. I also duplicate the pads layer, as we're going to use this later for a solder mask. Next, we take an inkjet-friendly acetate and glue along the one edge to a piece of paper so that it's got a good enough amount of thickness to pass through the printer. In my experience, trying to print directly onto acetate with an inkjet printer can sometimes be problematic and it causes jams. Adding a piece of paper means that it's thicker and has something to grip onto. Using an artist backlight and a piece of paper as a diffuser, I assemble the mask. Using two pieces of acetate means that we can double up on the mask itself. This has the advantage of removing any defects from the printed areas on the acetate, meaning that all the areas are totally black and will prevent light from coming through. Now it's time to prepare the board to receive the circuit design. I start off by cleaning the board, firstly with some steel wool and then with some isopropanol or rubbing alcohol to remove any oils left over from handling the board. I then cut a piece of dry film slightly oversized. Dry film is a UV sensitive coating I apply, allowing me to expose and transfer the artwork to the copper. Using two pieces of tape, one on either side of the dry film, I remove one of the protective coatings so we can apply the dry film to the board. I then apply the dry film to the board, taking care to remove as many bubbles as I can. The dry film is then trimmed to the size of the board. I pass the board through a laminator to make the dry film adhere to the board. The etch mask is then applied and attached with bulldog clips. A timer is then set for the board to be exposed in natural daylight. The duration of the timer will depend on the current conditions. For example, cloudy days will take around 15 minutes, where a sunny day only takes 4. To develop the board, I use this oxygen bleach detergent. It dissolves the dry film that has not been exposed to UV, leaving behind areas that are to be removed during etching. Once dissolved, the board is washed in plain water and dried. Next, the board is etched by dropping it into ferric chloride acid. The ferric chloride dissolves the exposed copper, leaving behind our design. To remove the etch mask, we use caustic soda and plain water. Caustic soda dissolves the remaining mask, revealing the board. So that first attempt didn't turn out the way I wanted. There were some issues with the trace width, meaning that when the etch completed, some of the traces actually got burnt through. So some of the changes I'm going to make is make the trace width wider to make it more resistant to the acid, and also the spacing between traces, meaning that there's a better separation between them. So let's do a redo and see how it turns out. Now it's time to do the solder mask. So essentially we repeat the process we did for the etch mask, but this time we're gonna mask off the pads. Next up, we have the tedious task of drilling all the holes. Once all the holes have been drilled, it's time for assembly. I place the components on the board in their locations, making sure that they're orientated correctly where that is required. I place the Arduino and the MP3 player on a set of risers, so these can be removed if there are any issues or if they need to be reused for another project. So all in all, I'm really pleased with how this circuit board turned out, and I hope Carol will be pleased with it too. I must admit, it's not perfect, but what would you expect from a homemade PCB? Now, there are fabrication houses that we can send the files to have this professionally made. Now, there is a project that I've got that I could do with such a service. So if you want to see what that project is, why not hit the subscribe button and the bell icon so you don't miss upcoming videos. Until next time, stay creative.